How is everybody doing? Having a difficult time with COVID? Yeah. I hope everyone's family is safe. Yeah. Adults and everybody. I believe you wanted to ask me some questions. So I'll just make an opening statement and then you can ask me a question. As everybody knows, the world is going through a COVID pandemic and it's quite a difficult time for everybody. We had suggested to the national government that they should take certain actions that we felt would help our people, especially the weaker sections, farmers, laborers. Unfortunately, they didn't take those actions. They didn't inject money into the system as quickly as they should have, and that has made the problem worse. And the weakest people in our country have taken the main brunt of the disease. I think the national lockdown done without any warning has created certain issues. Large numbers of our laborers who were forced to walk back home faced a tragedy. But that is the past, and I think now the nation needs to look positively at how to fight this disease. Please feel free to ask me any questions. Can you speak louder?
Dr. Harshavardhan also spoke about the Kerala area regarding the situation. So how is your conscience? How you are dealing with it? And what sort of precautionary measures that you have taken in Malappuram district as well as the wider district?
Well, I have had two meetings with the administration here. I think the central idea that Kerala is following, which is naturally the idea that Kerala always follows, is a decentralized response. A response more based on the people of Kerala. Healthcare workers, panchayats, doctors. So it is to me the spirit of the people of Kerala that are giving a good result here, decent result here. Of course, there are shortcomings, like there are in every situation. But overall, I feel that the spirit of Kerala, spirit of people of Kerala is going to overcome this disease here. In Wayanad, there are some unique requirements. There are weaker sections, there are tribal populations, so we have to be a bit more careful and provide a bit more support to those who are weaker. I suggested that in the meetings today. Overall, I think in Wayanad, the work being done is okay, it's good. You said about the Harshvardhan ji. I think it's an unfortunate comment. This whole nation has to fight this disease together, and I don't think it's appropriate to blame someone or the other. I think the spirit should be, let us overcome this challenge, and it's a huge challenge. I had warned the government of India, in fact, Harshvardhan ji himself, publicly in February, that India was facing a huge challenge, and it was not taken seriously. But I feel the time to sort of point fingers is not right now. I think right now we should all work together. Can we do your question at the end, because as we are in Kerala, I'd like to do all the Kerala stuff first, then we can come to you. Anybody else?
There was a controversy regarding the MSDP container. An online inauguration was cancelled in the last minute last week. And it was, according to the state government, there were no consultants before. So
look, frankly, an inauguration is not really the central idea. I mean, okay, if an inauguration is cancelled, it's fine. I don't really have a real problem with it. But I think I am a representative of the people of Wayanad, like many other representatives. I'm not alone. I'm a member of parliament. They are MLAs. They are pradhans. They are all sorts of public representatives, and we represent the voice of the people, right? And I think that that voice of the people must not be curtailed. So you must not try to curtail the voice of the people simply because I come from a different political party or a different political ideology. Inauguration, it's fine. It's not. It doesn't cause me much of a problem. I think because, especially when we are fighting a pandemic, all views are important. I think it's very important that the opposition also has a space, is able to express its viewpoint, because after all, we all represent the viewpoint of the people of India.
Sir, yes. Through this BMC meeting, also participated in the chief minister's, the minister's office of Kerala is not allowed to participate, co-chairman of BMC and the skip on their cabinet seat. Do you think this is fair or good for a democratic government? This type of politics.
See, again, question is not whether it is fair or not. Question is that all of us are public representatives and we all have a role. When I sit in the meeting, I am bringing a perspective to that meeting, and that perspective is not my personal perspective. It's the perspective of the people that I represent. I fight for those people. Same with somebody who works at the panchayat level. Same with an MLA. It doesn't matter which party is from, it's bringing a perspective. And I think it's unfortunate that you do not allow that perspective into the room, right? I think the more public representatives who are allowed to speak on behalf of the people, the better it is. And I think this is the spirit of Kerala. So it's unfortunate. But it will not stop us. It will not stop us from raising the views of the people. Yesterday we were in a meeting, and if you speak to the people in the meeting, it was a productive meeting. They suggested many ideas that we thought were useful. We suggested many ideas that they thought were useful, and the end result is better for everybody. There's no harm in allowing public representatives to discuss people's issues. It's not going to harm anybody. And especially in a time like COVID, it's important that people feel that their view is also being represented inside the government. It will actually help the government to listen to panchayat leaders from all parties.
Sir, the question related to your inauguration campaign last week. Do you think that it's a pre-election political game of left regime government?
I've already answered the question. I don't want to get into a blame game type of situation. I'm here, as I said, to help put on the table the view of the people of Wayanad. If I feel that farmers of Wayanad are feeling something, I will put it in the meeting so that the administration is aware of it, and I will push that sentiment. So my job is to push the viewpoint of the public inside meetings or even in conversations like this. Of course, there is an election. I mean, it's fine. It's not the end of the world. I fight the government of Kerala here, and I fight them ideologically, but that does not stop me from giving advice that I find useful for the people of Kerala. I will not give advice because they are my political opponents. I will give advice that is beneficial to the people of Kerala, and I think it is a good thing if the government also listens. Not a bad thing. It will help them in fact. Okay, anybody? Anybody else?
Yes. What are your care about the small-scale farmers in Kerala?
Well, this evening I'm having a very interesting meeting, which is about the rice growers, and how we can think about marketing Wayanad rice. So I think there's a lot of potential in different areas in Wayanad. There's potential in rice, there's potential in turmeric, other areas. We're having that conversation. I think there is a tragedy unfolding at the national level as far as agriculture is concerned. And it is going to be a devastating tragedy. And government in Punjab has just taken steps to try and avert it. These three new laws that the government has come up with are going to break the back of Indian agriculture. They're not just going to break the back of small farmers, they're going to break the back of every single farmer. And these three laws are designed, in a sense, to open the path for one or two big business players. They're designed to take the agricultural strength of India, the food security of India, and give it to two or three key players that are close to the Prime Minister. I'm not going to repeat their names, you know their names. So this is a devastating blow to the farmers. And what is the real tragedy? It has been done at the time of COVID. You could have waited 6 months, you could have waited 1 year, but it was done at the time of COVID because the government feels that the farmer will not be able to resist at the time of COVID. The farmer will not be able to stand up for his rights at the time of COVID. The government is wrong. The Indian farmer is the backbone of this country and he will resist these laws. And we are going to help him resist these laws. I think these laws are dangerous. They are dangerous for the country. They will impact food security of this country and they will devastate the lives of millions of farmers. I'll tell you a little bit about the idea. Currently, there is a food security system in India that is structured around procurement, MSP, and the mandi system. And these laws are designed to destroy this architecture. They're designed to destroy the mandi system, destroy procurement, destroy MSP, and as a result, they will destroy food security, which will be a terrible blow. It will take us back 50 years. Yes, and I'm aware of that. I think if you look at Wayanad, and not the country, but at Wayanad, I think there are many unique opportunities for small-scale farmers in Wayanad. I think there's a lot that can be done with regards to marketing their product, with regards to exporting some of their product, with regards to improving the productivity. I think there's a lot that can be done. In fact, in our meeting today, we had some suggestions and we're going to have deeper conversations. I think one of the things that I would like to see is, just like basmati rice is sort of a patented, branded idea, I would like to see some of Wayanad's rice to become a global, patented, branded idea. So I think there's a lot of scope and it's quite exciting. Currently the problem that small scale farmers are having, which we also raised in the meeting, is that the subsidy that they normally get has been taken away from them because of COVID, because they are unable to pay their interest on their loans, so their subsidy has been taken away. This is a real problem for them.
There is no subsidy for electricity
and other facilities. Yeah. But let's allow others to ask questions. We are going into some of these things in detail.
Kamilji, as you know, there is a controversy about Kerala CM on gold smuggling case, and opposition leader demands for his resignation. What's your reaction on it?
Look, I think there is already the NIA and others are investigating this issue, and I think let's see where that investigation goes. Let's see where it goes, and I think justice must prevail in all counts. Anybody else?
No.
Any last Kerala questions, or can we go to the national level? No more? Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
Yeah, yesterday the ED has questioned a very senior leader, Farooq Abdullah, for many hours, and he was also complaining that they did not even give him a permission to have his lunch for a very elderly person like that. So how do you perceive the intervention of central agencies in these cases, considering the
We have seen a tendency now for the current government to use agencies as political weapons. If somebody is not doing what they want politically, across the board, they feel they can use the CBI and the ED to pressurize them, to threaten them, to hurt them. This is something that it's not only Mr. Farooq Abdullah, but many people are facing. I am personally facing this assault. I have number of cases against me, and there are many leaders who are facing this assault. This is tragic because it is going to destroy these institutions. These institutions are designed to give justice to the people of India. They are not designed to be political instruments. So I do not appreciate using CBI and ED to do your political work. They are India's instruments. They are not personal instruments of the Prime Minister, and they should be treated as such.
I'll tell you my view
on this. I was stopped from going to Hathras by the government of Uttar Pradesh because a young girl was raped and killed. I think one cannot treat women with disrespect. One cannot, Kamalnath ji is from my party, but I don't like personally the type of language that Kamalnath ji has used. And I don't appreciate it. I think it's unfortunate. But as a general statement, I think that our treatment of women in this country at all levels has a lot to be improved. There's a lot to be improved, whether it is in the law and order, whether it is in just basic respect, whether it is in how much space they are accorded in business, in government, in other areas. I think our women are our pride. I think they should be protected, and I don't appreciate this type of language, regardless of who's using it.
Even your good old friend Mr. Sindhya has said that Congress never respects women. How do you see it, sir? Because he was aware with you.
Well, look. Please take a look at our record. Take a look at our record right from the freedom struggle. You know, we are not. Our record is pretty clear, it's open, and in fact I've just made a statement here against something that one of our leaders has made. I don't think Mr. Sindhya or anybody else would make this type of statement about his leadership. And as I believe Kamal Nath ji has already said that his statement was unfortunate. Well, our position on that is pretty clear. We've made it very, very clear. We believe that uniting the people of India is what strengthens this country. We believe that all people should be brought together. All people should be respected, and we feel that when you divide the people of this country, like the BJP does, you strengthen our opponents. BJP needs to reflect on why the Chinese have the power to be sitting inside Indian territory today. The Chinese have taken more than 1200 square kilometers of Indian territory. The BJP needs to think about why. What has given the Chinese this strength? I'll tell you what has given the Chinese this strength. Chinese have got this strength to sit inside India because the BJP has destroyed India's economy, because they have mishandled COVID, because at every opportunity they divide this country, because they take decisions without asking the people of this country. And that is why we have a foreign power occupying 1200 square kilometers of our land. And we have our Prime Minister lying to our nation about this occupation. The Prime Minister has himself said, and this is a lie, that nobody has taken any land from this country. The army is negotiating with the Chinese. The army believes otherwise. The defense ministry believes otherwise. But the Prime Minister is not able to face the reality that his misgovernance, his incompetence, has allowed the foreign power to take over 1200 square kilometers of our country. And one of the big reasons this is happening is because everywhere the Prime Minister goes, everywhere he goes, he weakens this country's basic structure. When you crush the press, when you take over institutions, when you incite people against each other, you are weakening India. It is very important that every Indian understands this, that when we are united, we are strong. When we are united, nobody can challenge us. When we are divided, when we are fighting amongst each other, we are weak. And then you will have things like what is happening currently. I think we have last question and we go.
PM Modi is addressing to the
UN. You've asked for.
What do you expect?
Sorry?
PM Modi addressing to the national.
What do I expect? I'm not a soothsayer. I don't have the ability to predict these type of things. But I can say that the real challenge is in front of the country. I mean, what I'd like to hear from the Prime Minister is when the Chinese are going to leave Indian territory. It is this is shocking to me. I don't think there's any other country in the world today where a foreign power can take 1200 square kilometers of the country, right? And there's no answer from the leadership. There's no country in the world where if their territory is taken, the Prime Minister can simply say it never happened. So what I'd like the Prime Minister to tell us, the nation, is when the Chinese are going to be thrown out of Indian territory. What is the date by which the Chinese soldiers are going to be kicked out of India? That's what I want to know. But I guarantee you, the Prime Minister won't have the guts to say that. The Prime Minister will not be able, will not, I'll tell you right now, that the Prime Minister will not say one word about the Chinese. He will not be able to say the word China. Let's see if I'm wrong. Thank you.